Hello and a very warm welcome to Spectrum On Air. Now we have a very special guest in the studio. You can see him across the way here. I'm going to introduce to you the wonderful, a man of many talents from East Kilbride. This is Kevin Devine. Kevin, hi.
Hello, how are you? How are you? I'm delighted to be here, by the way.
I'm dead nervous, you know, because I'm talking to a pro. And I know how you nobble people, so...
Well, as I was once given a bit of advice by Esther, she said, don't get worried about people that you think are impressive or celebrities, whatever. Just imagine them sitting in the toilet and that'll take away all the mystique and all the, so just imagine them sitting there on the loo and there is no mystery left.
So, Kevin, take us back in time. Come on, tell us about your career and that infamous long queue that you were in for a particular show, which was very, very popular.
It was That's Life, as you know, was the leading sort of consumer show that had been on television. It started in 1973. We've actually just passed its 50th anniversary of it hitting the air. And I had grown up, like a lot of people, watching the show.
Yeah.
So in 1991, Adrian Mills announced that he was going to leave the show. He was going on to do People Today, which was a live television show and a great opportunity for him. So he announced he was leaving. And Esther then said, so what we're going to do, we are going to have an open audition for presenters. Now, as someone who had I'd done a bit of DJing, I'd done a little bit of acting, I'd always wanted to go on the television. So when I heard the word open audition, I thought, oh, you don't need to have qualifications, you don't need to have been to drama school or whatever, I'm going to give this a go. Naively, simplistic way of looking at things, I could do that. So I jumped on a train. I actually phoned the show on the Monday because it had been announced on the Sunday night. And I got this girl who answered the phone called Beth, who I ended up getting to know later on. And I said, oh, hello. No doubt you've had hundreds of calls today about this. She went, yes. And she was quite abrupt. And I said, oh, I'm just checking. I'm going to come down from Scotland. So is there any way I can definitely be seen? And she went, nope. And I went, okay. How many people do you expect to come along? She said, well, we're shutting the door after the first couple of thousand and we expect people to start queuing tonight, which was a Monday night. So I thought, oh, it'd be terrible if I travelled down there and couldn't get in. So I just jumped on a train. I booked a sleeper down from Edinburgh because I was living just outside Edinburgh at the time. And I went and I arrived in at the Hammersmith Pally at about 7 o'clock the following morning, expecting to see massive queues. And I was the first person there.
No, you were the first one in the queue.
I was the first person to arrive. And that actually was the best thing that ever could have happened. So I then phoned the show again from a phone box and I said, hello. And Beth was a lot softer the next day. And I said, hi, I'm just checking that I'm at the right place, the Hammersmith Pally. And she said, no, that's where the audition is, but it's tomorrow. And I said, it's just that I seem to be the first person here, you know. And she said, where have you come down from? I said, Scotland. She said, well, good luck. And, we'll see what happens. So I hung up the phone and then I wandered back down and sort of joined the queue. And a few people started arriving through the day then. And by
you knew you were in the right place.
Yes, so I knew I was in the right place. Everyone was going, is this the queue for the auditions? Yeah, this is it. Join me. So there were a couple of hundred people that arrived by about 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock that night. And then, of course, the Hammersmith Pally opened. So we were all kicked away from the front door because they had a nightclub to run. So they had to do their night. So we all went across the street and we camped out. And then a few of the directors came down from the show because and they'd sent down a photographer to take a picture of me because I was the first person there. So going through the night, as I say, a few of the directors arrived with fish and chips and introduced themselves. And it was a gentleman called Michael Peretsky, who's ended up becoming one of my best friends. That was the first time I met him. And he was going around, making sure everyone was comfortable, handing out a bit of food, some water and things. And then they went away. And at about 4 o'clock in the morning, the Hammersmith Pally was closed. And they said, you can come back over. So I ran back over. And of course, everyone pushed in and there were barriers set up. And I wasn't actually technically at the front of the queue now. There was another fellow. So London, as you know, is buzzing all the time. But between about 4 and 5, there was a little lull. And I remember being cramped up on the pavement, trying to sleep on my knees like this, up against the barrier. And then, of course, the noise started and everyone got excited and more people were arriving. So, and then around about 8:30, all the presenters started arriving. Esther got out of her car. And then a researcher called Angela Wallace came out of the Hammersmith Palais and said, where's this chap that's front of the queue? And the fellow that had run over the previous night went, I am. And I was standing there going, didn't see anything. But the girl beside me, she went, no, you're not. Kevin's been here the longest. So she went, okay. It's just to let you know, Esther wants to speak to you. So everyone went, oh. And I went, oh. Oh, she wants to speak to me. So anyway, she came out. We did a little interview. And I naively thought, because I'd been filmed, I was definitely going to be on the television. Yeah. I had no idea about the edit room and the cutting room floor. As they say, you know, oh, we're not using that. Get rid of that. Get rid of that. So anyway, and we then went inside to the auditions. And once again, because I'd been on the streets for such a long time.
You must have been shattered and you must have looked shattered.
Well, this is exactly what I'm getting. I was shattered and I thought, I'm going to go and have a quick brush up and brush my teeth and, you know, wash under the arms and things, you know. So I'm sure if anyone's watching this from the forces, they'll get that. You know, you just go into the toilets, quick rub, and away you go. And by the time I came out, of course, I was at the back of the queue again. So because everyone had been lined up to sort of get ready for the judges. So anyway, they gave us a quick warm-up. They warmed up our voices because we were all going to sing. And then a producer called Richard Wolfe, who was the senior producer on the show, he said, this is what's going to happen, folks. You will all be brought forward. You'll be given a sheet of A4 paper, which you have to read, and read as if you're on the show. And then he said, and by the way, if there's a gentleman called Kevin Devine here, could he make himself known? So I put my hand up right at the back of the queue, and he said, oh, if you don't mind, could you come forward to the front? So people started parting, you know, it was like Moses parting the waves.
But they were looking at you going, oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's exactly what happened, Suzanne. They were all going, who's this guy? And drawing me looks. And as I was walking up, Richard said, just in case you're wondering why we're bringing him forward, it's just that Kevin has queued the longest. He's been here since yesterday morning and he was front of the queue. So we just want to make sure that he's, you know, he's coming forward. And at that point, they actually gave me a round of applause.
Yeah.
So that was really nice. So anyway, I went forward and it was just sitting in front of a chair, like I'm sitting now and talking to you as if Esther was there. And I read out this A4 sheet of paper. I was filmed doing it. And I just tried to imagine I was on the show. And it was something really strange. Like, and of course, Mrs. Smith had never seen a giraffe in a living room before. So she was worried it might hit the ceiling because it was so tall. And that's not the kind of thing that you normally see in Surbiton. So it was one of those sort of little that's life paragraphs.
Yeah.
And then she said, thank you very much. You're through to the next round. So people were getting, you know, some people were being eliminated. A lot of people were being eliminated. I managed to get through to the next round. So we sort of went up onto a little stage. And sorry, you can see I'm very descriptive with my hands. We went up on a little stage at the Hammersmith Palais and a few people that I'd queued with managed to get through as well. So there was a little bit of camaraderie.
Yeah.
Which was great and built up. And do you know what, something, it was only years later that I found out that one of the people that queued in that queue and never got through was Dale Winton.
No.
Yeah. Dale was there and Dale never got through. And I ended up being warm-up guy to Dale for about 10 years. When he was doing In It to Win It and things, I was his warm-up guy.
How things change and reverse, don't they?
And that's just, we had a conversation about it. This is when I found out later on. And Dale said, oh God, I was there, Kevin. I remember you being there. And he said, and of course, they never picked me. And I jokingly said, I said, well, I wonder who had the best career choice, Dale, you know, because he was at the height of his fame at that time. Although I wouldn't have changed the thing, I have to say, because that life was wonderful. So That was it for the day. We then had a second audition that day where you had to sing. You had to sing a song.
Why did you have to sing when you were going to be presenting? Well, it seemed an odd thing to get you to do.
We did a lot of campaigns, things like Get Britain Singing. Now, that's where we would all dress up and hang around places. The first one I did was the Natural History Museum.
Right.
And I was dressed as a caveman. And back in those days, I've never been like a muscle man, as you can see. But back in those days, I was still very skinny. Yeah. So I had this off-the-shoulder fur thing round and some sort of loincloth or whatever. And I stood with a club very still. And then when people came by, I jumped out and started singing to them. So that was why we had to be able to sing. Also, some of the stories that we covered in That's Life, we actually sang them. Depending on, you know, if it was a lighthearted story.
Yes, I remember that now, yes.
She would sometimes write a little song where we told the story. So you had to be able to sing. And over the years, Grant Bainham was a great musician. Bill Buckley was a great singer. I think he could play the piano as well. Michael Groth was another one. He was previous to me. Michael was a great guitarist and could also sing. Funnily enough, Adrian was not the best singer. And Adrian's one of my best pals. Now, we've had a friendship for over 30 years now. And he'll be the first to admit he's not the best singer. So in fact, I'll just tell you a wee quick story. He'll kill me for telling this. But when we did Panto together in Cardiff, and he was Prince Charming, I was Dan Deeney. Ronnie Corbett was Buttons. So we had a great cast. And during the Cinderella, you know, the slipper scene, as they call it, where Cinderella runs off and leaves the ball, and Prince Charming goes, "Where is she? Where is she?" "Oh, Your Highness, all that's left is this slipper." So Adrian picks up the slipper, and all the dancers come out on stage, and he's going, "Whoever this slipper shall fit, I will marry." So he starts walking around the stage, and I went backstage up the stairs, and I sang A Whole New World. And that was my song, so I sang that, and Adrian walked about. Now, at the back of the theatre, they used to take a little video of the whole stage. So it was a big wide shot, as they called it. And they gave us all a copy as a memento. And some years later, when Adrian started dating his wife, Nikki, I came down to London to meet her. They'd been going out about 5 or 6 months. And we're sitting there and she said, "Well, of course, and Adrian's got such a beautiful singing voice." And I looked at Adrian and Adrian went, "Does anyone want a cup of tea or anything?" And I went, no, "Hang on a second here. What do you mean by that, Nikki?" And she said, "Oh, Adrian showed me a video of him singing in Cinderella. And he's got a beautiful voice, such a good singing voice." And I looked up at Adrian, and Adrian was still going, "Are you sure you don't want a cup of tea? You do it." And I said, "Adie, what video are you talking about?" And she went, "Oh, the one from Cinderella. You know, that's him singing on it." And I said, "It's not him singing. That was me." You know, so one of the reasons she liked him was because of his singing voice. And,
oh, gosh. And
we all burst out laughing. We all burst out. And we still joke about it to this day. So the running joke is that if ever Adrian has to sing, I'll say, "You just sing and I'll mime behind you." Or "You mime and I'll sing behind
you." Lip sync. You lip sync me.
Yeah, you lip sync me. So it became a standard. And of course, they went on to become married and are, you know, two of my best friends. And
are wonderful. Well, That's Life was quite a controversial programme, but it was watched, wasn't it, by, you know, millions, 20 million people it was watched by. But it touched the hearts of people because it was ordinary people with extraordinary stories, wasn't it? What was your best and worst moment on the series?
Well, for me personally, without a doubt, was getting the job. You know, it was wonderful to actually become part of that show. That's the selfish part of me saying that. That was the best thing. During the show, as part of the job, I really enjoyed going to America because I had to fly over there to do two films. One was a painting dog called Rosie in Phoenix Zoo, and the other one was surfing dogs in La Jolla in San Diego.
Yeah.
So the painting elephant Rosie was amazing. They had discovered if they set up a canvas and put colours out in front of her, she would pick a colour, then she would pick a brush. And she would use her trunk to take the brush.
Oh, I remember that one. Yes. Yeah.
She would attack the screen, you know, the canvas.
Yeah.
And it was like an impressionist painting.
Yes. Yeah. It was so, random strokes, wasn't it? And
absolutely.
Splashes of colour and all sorts of stuff.
Absolutely. And she would then go on board with that one. And she would throw the brush down, say, and pick another one and pick another colour. So in some way, she was interpreting what she saw around her and trying to put images down on paper and how this came about, we don't know. Nobody knows. She just wanted to do this one day. So I took that painting back. We flew it back to Britain. I wasn't sure if it was worth anything. You know, when you're coming through customs, it says declare, you know, to declare. So I went through the declare channel and the security officer all come up and I said, "Look, I work in That's Life. An elephant painted this.
I bet he thought, oh yeah.
I don't know if it's worth anything, but I thought I would show you it just in case. And they just burst out laughing, went, on you go, mate. On you go. So that was fine. And then we took the painting to three different art experts. And the first two were very serious about, oh, I can see heat. I can see the disposition, broad, bold brush strokes. This, you know, I can see that this artist is drawn from whatever environment is seeing. And then the third art critic was a guy called Brian Sewell. And Brian was with Evening Standards. And if you remember Brian, if you ever saw him, he was frightfully, frightfully posh. And he knew everything about classics and Rembrandt and, you know, impressionists. He was such a knowledgeable man. And I showed him the painting and I said, Brian, this is one of America's hottest artists at the moment. He went, oh, it's terrible. It's absolutely bloody awful. And I said, but these paintings are going for £10,000. Americans are queuing up to buy them. And he said, well, that tells you everything about Americans, right? And he was very disparaging about it. And he goes, there's no skill here. The brush strokes are terrible. There's no skill. And then, of course, at the end, I said, well, it was actually painted by an elephant. And they said, ah, I suspected as much when I got a call from that slide. So that was a great story to do. And then the following day, we flew over to San Diego. And we had these wonderful surfing dogs that I don't know if they were the first to ever do it, but their owners put them on little boogie boards and put them out to sea, and they would let them catch a wave, and the dogs would ride the wave in and then jump off onto the beach. So the idea was that I would go out with the dog and try and come in with them. And of course, I had never surfed before. So I swam out, and the guy's going, you just do this, just do that, ride the wave, you know, sit there. I'll push you to sort of do the thing. So of course he went, ah, this is the wave coming, and this wave started coming in. He went, there you go. And of course he's going, right, kneel. And of course I went, oh, and off I went. And I got caught in the undertow, and I was it wasn't the most elegant shot, because I just was thrown onto the beach. You know, everyone else is surfing in and jumping off. The dogs surfed in and jumped off, and I was like a beached whale, just lying. So and I got rolled over, and there was sand, and, you know, it was just off. But the director went, great shot, that's funny, you know, we're going to use that.
It's a shame, isn't it, that it's not still on today? Because I think we need this kind of entertainment today. Both, you know, the heartfelt and the very tragic stories that you unfolded, but also the humorous side as well. I mean, gosh, our televisions have got so depressing lately, haven't they? I think
there is a tendency towards that, towards too much of the drama. And the great thing about That's Life, you mentioned it earlier, it was all about the viewers' stories. We used to get 10,000 letters a week. Yeah. And they used to bring them in massive big buckets, and we would all, every single one of them was read, because the whole production team would come in, we'd all dive in, we'd take a pile of letters, and we'd go through looking for stories. So it was the viewers that generated the stories. And at the height of our show, it was actually 25 million people that were watching. One in three of the UK population tuned into That's Life. And that's why the campaigns that we did were so powerful. And all the serious ones, I don't know if you remember Ben Hardwick. Ben was a little 2-3-year-old boy, and he needed a liver transplant.
Yeah.
And his parents wrote to us, and as a last resort, if you like. And Esther picked up on the story, and she said, right, we're going to try and do something to help this wee boy. And at that time, organ donation wasn't really very common. Mm-hmm. It wasn't well known. A lot of people still didn't know it could be done. Yeah. So there was a lot of ignorance about it, not in a bad way, but just people didn't know. So when that campaign started, the first week we were flooded with calls and letters about what can I do to help? Because as you know, with organ donation, you have to have a very close match.
Yeah, you do.
Familial or somebody with the same sort of DNA profile. So it's a very much a hit or miss thing. And of course, we were flooded with offers, and people started asking, how can I, if I can't help him, how can I help somebody else?
Yeah.
So we told them about the organ donor cards, and suddenly organ donation, or the people registering for it, started to go through the roof because of that campaign. And he did actually get a donor, and the liver transplant was made. Unfortunately, he only, I think he lived about another 9 months, But during that time, we still kept in touch. And the whole country was touched by it. I still get a wee bit emotional thinking about it.
Yeah.
Because that wee boy, that innocent wee boy,
changed so many lives. Yeah.
Exactly. Because his sacrifice saved tens of thousands, probably, since then, if not hundreds of thousands of people who have been able to take a liver, a kidney, a heart transplant, lung, whatever it's going to be, because of that campaign and people going, right, I want to help. And that was the great thing about the show, was when we did a campaign, people listened.
Yeah.
MPs listened.
You changed laws as well, didn't you? The show actually was instrumental in changing
absolutely,
laws.
Absolutely. And I mean, we never wrote it, but people would be in touch with us saying, what do you think we should do? And I have to say, politicians, it was mandatory in a lot of ways for them to watch the show. Because they knew that we were hitting stories that their constituents were going to be asking about. Yeah. And they would be saying, did you see that show last night? I've got a similar problem. Can you help? So the House of Commons must have, you know, everyone must have on a Sunday night just gone, that's life. We need to watch this.
Before we break and listen to one of your first songs, why did they stop it then, Kevin? Why did they stop
it? We had run for 21 years. And I think the BBC felt it was, the format was maybe getting a bit tired, even though we're still, towards the end, we were still getting 12, 14 million viewers.
Yeah.
Which nowadays shows would kill for. Although it was a very different listening environment or watching environment. There are more channels now, et cetera, et cetera. People have far more choice. But so I think there was a feeling within the BBC that they felt it had a good run.
Yeah.
And at the 20th series, they approached Esther and said, well, what would you do if that's life finished? And she said, well, I'd like to do some other things as well. So it was time for Esther as well. She'd devoted her whole life, her whole adult life to it. And as you know, I think at one point she was the third most powerful woman in Britain after after the Queen and Maggie Thatcher at that time.
Yeah.
So people did listen to her and they made fun of her at times, which was very unfair, but she didn't mind that because she knew.
She had a better, greater message to give.
Greater message. And if they were doing that, then they were leaving the stories alone.
Yeah.
Because she was a brilliant, brilliant journalist. And people underestimated that.
Yeah, they do. And I didn't realise that she produced the show. She wasn't just a presenter on it. She produced it. So she had a very hands-on approach to the whole show, didn't she?
She did. She was there first thing in the morning, and she was often there after everyone else was going at night. Because during the week, when That's Life was on the air, it was all consuming.
Yeah.
You had to be there. You had your weekend off sometimes, you know, because other times you'd be doing jobs and things. But that was it. It was, you had to get the show on there. Everyone pulled together and said, right, we're going out. We've got to get this in the can. Got to get recorded because all of these stories are important. So there you go. We're a great big family.
Yeah. So let's have a break and your first song. So what first song are you going to introduce us to and why, Kevin?
Okay. Right. The first song I'm going to tell you about is Chic and Le Freak.
Because
growing up, I was always a massive, massive, massive Chic fan.
Yeah.
And I actually wrote off to them in New York as a kid, saying, do you have any autograph photos or anything? And 6 months later, I got an autograph photo from Nile Rodgers, Bernard Edwards, and the rest of the girls in the band. And I was totally stunned. And I loved Le Freak as a kid, so much so that during one of the school discos, I hadn't been able to get the 12-inch single. And I asked this DJ who was doing the school discos, Skeleton Discos, do you have a copy of that? He says, well, I do, but I can't give you. It's mine, but I'll have a route round. And then at the next school disco, about 9 months later, he went, by the way, the fella that asked me for this 12-inch of Le Freak, I've got it. And I went forward, and of course, I'd brought my pocket money along for the school disco, which was maybe a couple of quid. And he said, that'll be £2. So I had nothing. I had nothing to buy Cokes or Chris, you know, whatever at that age. But I was so delighted to get the 12-inch. And I remember Niles Rogers talking about how the song started. They had been refused entry to Studio 54 on New Year's Eve in 1976 or something. They were just up and coming. They were not back. And they went back to his apartment, him and Bernard Edwards, and they started jamming. And Freak Out was actually F off. They were shouting. That's how it started, right? I hope I can get away with saying that rather than having to bleep me. But that was what it was. And they were jamming along with this riff. Ah, F off. You know, they were singing that. And then they went, actually, this is really grooving. You know, this is really grooving. So because of that knockback, it inspired, and they changed the word to freak out rather than F-O.
Yeah.
Same letters, but, you know, and it became, of course, this massive worldwide hit. And I loved it. I loved it. I loved it. So that was one of the first songs that I really had an attachment to.
Well, let's have a listen to that. And now I'm listening to it. I'm going to be transposing that word, and I suspect everybody that's listening will do the same
Nobody.
Thing.
Nobody will hear it in the same way anymore. You know?
No, they won't. No. So we'll be back in just a moment because we've got lots more to talk about with Kevin. So don't go away. Stay with us because we'll be back very shortly just after this song. Hello, welcome back to Spectrum On Air with the lovely Kevin Devine. Now, we were talking earlier and we touched on it a little bit just as we were leaving to listen to that first song. So, Kevin, I want you to explain to me what Devine encounters were, because I cannot imagine how on a London street you walked up to unsuspecting celebrities with a microphone and a cameraman and they didn't tell you where to go, because normally journalists and reporters, they treat you all with trepidation, don't they? But there you were, nobbling them all and talking so openly. How the hell did you manage that?
I just tried to be nice to people. And the good thing was, as I explained to them You know, I would actually ask them first. You know, we did ask them first. When we first started it, we were sort of surprising them a wee bit, and it was a bit uncomfortable, I think, for some of them. So I said, look, well, let's just approach them and tell them what we're doing, and then we can start the interview. But loads of people were very receptive to it, because the good thing about it was a chat show on the streets. So there's no constriction. You can be yourself. You can talk about whatever you want, because that was the beauty of it. We never edited.
Yeah.
We just said, right, you talk as long as you want to talk, and talk about whatever you're plugging, whatever you're doing. And I would just try and pick up on what they were saying and keep the conversation going. So, you know, we had some wonderful people, Chris Evans, Suggs from Madness.
I watched that one, and he had a pint of beer in his hand. He was almost like, what are you doing here, mate?
That was one of the very first interviews. And it was from that experience, I thought, maybe we should just go up and ask them. Although he was a true pro. He got it right. I get this. Right, okay.
Yeah. And then in between, he kind of came, you're pretty good at this.
That's right. So, you know, and I bumped into him a couple of times after it, and I thanked him and everything. They went, no problem. So, you know, because people do approach him all the time, because he's so famous. You know, he sucks from Madness, you know. Everyone knows his face. Everyone knows his great songs. So it was very good. And one of the early ones as well was Chris Evans. And I had briefly met Chris years ago. I mean, so briefly, he wouldn't have remembered. And I approached him and I said, you know, I introduced myself. I told him what we're doing. I said, would it be possible to get a quick couple of minutes with him? And he was such a trooper. And I think I mentioned, I said, because I used to work in That's Life. And Chris was a big fan of That's Life. He was a big fan. So it gave him a couple of, you know, 3 or 4 minutes of just pure TV gold.
Yeah.
And he was great.
It looked like he'd come out from behind a lamppost.
He did. That's what I'm saying. We started rolling and he hid behind the lamppost and then he came out. And that's why I was just laughing right away when he did this. And he was such a trooper. And as I say, and off he went into the sunset. So, and Caroline Quentin, the actress, she was lovely. And I had a little in with her because she'd been recording up in Scotland previously. And I did a lot of work at BBC Scotland. And all the crew and everything saying, oh, she was up doing a sitcom and she was great. And so I had that as a little in. So you just have to approach people nicely. And
how did you find them all, though? Because I go to London and I never see anybody.
We used to have 3 or 4 little lookout points. And
spotters.
This was me and Michael Bretzky, who was my great friend. And he was the sort of producer cameraman. And between us, he came up with the idea. It was really, at the beginning, he phoned me one day when I was on my radio show up in Scotland. And he said, oh, Christopher Biggins has just walked by. Hello, Christopher. Speak to my friend. You're on his radio show just now. And I said, oh, hello, Christopher. Hi, I'm broadcasting in Scotland. What are you up to? Oh, I'm going for a voiceover. I'm doing this. And he was lovely. And then, well, I've got to go. Bye. And from that, Mike said, you know, there's always famous people around Soho because all the production houses are there. They're all going in to do edits or voiceovers or photo shoots or, you know, whatever they're doing in their business. So it's a great sort of ground to spot. And we would basically pick certain points. We would hang around the corner and he would look one way. We were like meerkats. He would look one way. I would look the other. Then when we turned, we'd look across each other while we were talking and we would spot people. Not everyone said yes. Some people said no. There were a couple of people who were quite abrupt when they said no. I won't name names, but most people were like, I'm really sorry, I've got it. It's not a problem. Next time I see you, there's my card. I'd love to chat to you.
Yeah.
So if you're polite and professional with people, they sort of get it.
You seem to just find these people randomly on the street, then start talking to them. And that in the back of your head, you had an awful lot of knowledge about them, which they were quite surprised you'd pulled out.
You're very flattering to say that. Because sometimes I had very little knowledge of people. But what I did do, and I think for any, you know, would-be interviewers listening, is to listen. Because they will say something that you can then pick up on and take the conversation away. And that was one of the things I learned in That's Life. Esther, you know, listen to what they're saying. Don't just go through, I'm going to ask this question, that question, this. Because they might take you in a direction which is really rich with quotes or stories or things. So that's what you were always. I was a good listener, and I would try and pick up and go, oh, so you're doing that. One of the best ones we ever did was Tamer Hassan, and it's probably, I think it's 100 and odd thousand views it's had. And I had actually interviewed Tamar about a year previously on my radio show in Scotland, but I'd never met him. So we spotted him, and I introduced myself, and I said, look, mate, you gave a brilliant interview a while ago. I said, would you mind if I do? And he was just brilliant. He was so himself. He gave us a great interview. He really bought into it. He swore a wee bit that he was just being himself, but he was gold. He was absolutely, you know, TV gold. And he actually put it up on his channel and directed it to his fans. And the comments we had on it are just amazing. Absolutely amazing. And we're still getting, you know, some of those interviews were over 10 years ago now. And we're still getting people viewing and commenting on them today.
Yeah, which is wonderful, isn't it? Well, because they were so, if you like, raw, so natural, yes, and off the cuff. There was no script, so people can see that it just was as you had bumped into them in the street.
Yeah.
And now, for a self-confessed blatherer, I've got to keep him short because we're going to run out of time. What's your next song that you're going to introduce us to, and why?
It's Visage and Fade to Grey.
Oh, okay.
Because that song blew me away when I first heard it. And it also kicked off something in my life which was really bizarre, because in the video of Fade to Grey, they do this thing getting into the chorus where they say, in the fade to grey, and they sort of did this thing, you know, where they brushed their hand across the face. And I started doing this at the school disco, and I ended up going into a bit of robotics, which I never knew I could do. And that kicked off a whole sideline career for me, because I ended up becoming a sort of a semi-professional robotic dancer.
Did you really?
I worked in a burger place in Glasgow called Buck Rogers, which was franchised from the Buck Rogers space TV show. So that the place was all done up with plastic panels. It looked like the inside of a spaceship. And I would walk about, and I used to work the weekends just walking about with dark glasses on and makeup and things in a jumpsuit, being a robot. And it got me a couple of TV appearances. And I also went into the That's Life robotic competition in 1983. And I never got anywhere in that, you know, but I ended up 8 years later winning the presenter competition.
Bizarre, isn't it? Isn't it bizarre how life takes you? But I tell you what, I speak to Rusty, not a lot, but I'm going to tell him that he inspired you to become a robotic dancer.
I follow Rusty on, so please, please, please do tell him, because I'm a massive fan of his music. I've downloaded all his latest things. You know, I don't know if you saw the Blitz documentary that was on.
Yes.
Fantastic. Absolutely fantastic.
Yeah.
In fact, I'm probably going to be meeting the director over the next couple of weeks, because he lives nearby me and I've been in contact. But Rusty is a phenomenal musician. Phenomenal.
Yeah. And he would be a great interviewee for you, actually. I can see you two together, because you can then show him your moves, can't you?
What a great idea. What a great... And of course, I met Steve Strange at one point. I was lucky enough to meet him and things. And it was just, the Visage were fantastic.
Phenomenal, phenomenal. So let's have a little break. Let's listen to Fade to Grey by Visage. And we'll be back very shortly, because we want to find out all about Kevin's singing and songwriting career next. So stay with me. We'll be back just shortly.
Devenir gris.
Well, hello, everybody. This is Spectrum on Air, and we're listening and talking with the wonderful Kevin Devine, who is a man of multi-talents, we're understanding now. Not only has he been a robotic dancer, he's been a presenter and interviewer, but he's also currently working on his original passion, his first love of music and songwriting. So, Kevin, take us back. Where did this start? Obviously, you sang that song, if I may say so, to get your presenting position on That's Life. And that song that you sang, did you make that up on the day, or had you been working on that knowing you had to do it? Because it was quite clever.
No, well, now, if you're talking about the song that I sang for my audition,
yes,
it was written for me by Esther. We had to sing our telephone So, right. And I can even remember, how I hope someone there will cast a vote for me, though I'm Scottish and I'm showing off my legs. You will like lots of things from Scotland, you'll agree. Like Scotch whiskey and Scotch salmon and Scotch eggs. Please, what was the next? But anyway, and it ended up singing 0898-654-104.
You did, yeah.
So Esther wrote that for me, and I was wearing the kilt and everything. It was all very Scottish and, you know, rouse the nation to get the votes in. So that was written for me. But I'd actually, before I joined That's Life, back in my very early 20s, I had been writing my own songs. And I worked with a guy called David Blakely. And Davey and I poached him from another band that I'd seen. And he played synthesizers and keyboards. And I thought, that's exactly, I've got words and lyrics and I need someone to play it. So we hooked up, and for about 18 months, we would beg, steal and borrow gear, a little four-track. He had a four-track, TIAC four-track, and a little Roland MC-202. I'm getting very geeky now.
You are, yeah.
It was a mini keyboard. Right. And you could program it. And then it took you ages to program. And then you had to back it up onto cassette tape. But it wasn't the actual sounds. It was like fax code that and then you had to reload it back on. And if the tape was gone, you'd lose all your work. So yeah. It was the very early days of, you know, getting towards digital, but not digital, still analog. And drum machines and things. So we managed to get together some songs. I've still got a demo tape somewhere, you know, from that time. And then, of course, we never got anywhere with it and was sort of split up and went our separate ways. And then just about 4 or 5 years ago, I got myself some gear again. I got a MacBook, I got a keyboard, and it suddenly just all started bursting out. And it came out like a torrent, I don't know. So I was getting all these songs together. And then my pal Chris Mars, who was with Flock of Seagulls, he's a brilliant keyboard player.
Oh, they are. I love Flock of Seagulls, yeah.
Oh, and yeah. He helped me. He said, right, get your songs together. I'll do some parts for you. Well, and I, if you need guitar parts, I know this guy. If you need drums, I know Chuck Sabo. Chuck Sabo drums for Elton John, take that. Robbie Williams. He's a gold disc of Circle of Life on his wall as you walk in. And Natalie Imbruglia, the first couple of albums, and her, you know, Torn, I don't know if you remember
yes,
her song.
Yeah,
Torn.
I do,
That's,
yeah, not
that's
that.
her chuck. And he's a wonderful drummer. He's amazing, technically amazing, and really, really just gets it. So I brought together all these musicians, sent them the parts, they recorded it, came back, went into the studio. And it took me a few years to get it done because I funded everything. So I saved up my money, went in, got a couple of days studio time, did a couple of songs, came back out, and just built it up like that. And I'm now working, I'm co-writing with other people as well. I'm in something called the Supergroup Pro, which is a collective of people from all different aspects of the music industry. A guy called Graham Godfrey and Sarah Devine formed a group during COVID, and it brings in artists, singer-songwriters, coaches, vocal coaches, people who know about the business side of music. So you're able to tap into all these different talents. Steve Anderson, who is Kylie's musical director, he's in it. And he's, so, you know, they're all so good with their time and their advice and, oh, their experience.
Yeah,
so
exactly,
for somebody like me, I'm like a sponge, just taking all this in and, you know, getting the tricks and techniques of how to write good songs and great songs.
Yeah.
Those little hooks and things. So that's how it's come about. And this is what I'm really pouring my passion into now, is to do this. And I've done it live a couple of times now, which I've really enjoyed. And I would love to get back out and sort of play the album and two people if they wanted to listen to it. So
your first debut album was 2020, is that right? And you've
that's
got a
correct.
Second. Is this the second album not out yet? It's still in production.
There's an EP coming out later on in the year, which I'm going to scale down because, as I say, I have to fund all this myself. So you can only afford so many things.
Yeah.
So I'm going to put out a 4 or 5 track EP. And the single that's just coming out next month is actually on the first album, but we've done a radio edit of it, and it's just I love the song.
Yeah.
It's probably the song I'm most proud of because I played everything on it.
Did you? Wow, that is a lot of work.
So I put together that whole thing, and I'm not great playing live, but because of the computers and everything, you can get your ideas out, and I'm not ashamed to say that because.
No.
Lots of musicians do that now. So because I'm a songwriter, I think, you know, a songwriter, singer, and I do that. And also there's a group called the Song Centre, which is a collective. Tim Fraser started it. Bill Padley's, who's another great songwriter, he wrote number ones for Atomic Kitten, for Liberty X back in the day. Tim's written songs for Tina Turner, Lulu. He's done the latest single for The Sweet.
Wow.
So he writes across all the genres, and he co-writes with some, you know, people like Terry Britton, all these wonderful songwriters. So I'm sort of being exposed to all this genius now, and hoping some of it eventually
is going to rub off on you. Well, I can hear
that.
In some of your tracks the synthesizers and your love of the electronic music.
Yes.
You know, I know you were inspired by Kraftwerk, Depeche Mode, Visage, all of those. So kind of that's my passionate era too. And it's lovely to hear you, you know, getting involved in. And of course, the young generation, you know, they are switched onto it. They're getting switched onto it now. And they're going, and yes, it is easy to create music in your bedroom, but a lot of people do not understand how much work is involved in putting that piece of music together. All the elements that you have to line up and make sure that it flows in a way. And then that's just the instrumentation.
Yeah.
The next bit is to get the lyrics in and make sure that they are in time and in tune. And it's a hell of a lot of work. Hell of a lot of work. Before we go on I could speak to you all day. What is the next song that you're going to introduce us to and why?
So talking about the electronic influence and things, it's going to be Love Songs by Simple Minds. Because back in Scotland, back in the day, we knew Simple Minds were going to be world superstars a long time before anyone else. And when I was hooking into all the new romantic thing, Simple Minds were unsigned at the time. But they sold out the Glasgow Apollo for 8 nights in a row. For an unsigned band, that was unheard of.
Yeah.
So everyone in Scotland, we all knew they were massive. And Love Song was on at the local nightclub. And it just, you know, that synthesizer at the beginning. And it just, I'm getting hairs standing up in my arms just now, even thinking about it. And we all thought Jim and the boys were just Scottish superheroes. And they were.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm picking Love Songs.
So this is Love Songs by Simple Minds, but don't go away because we've got more to talk with Kevin very shortly here on Spectrum On Air, the colourful voice of radio. You're listening to Spectrum On Air, the colourful voice of radio. And I have with me today in the studio the wonderful Kevin Devine. We've been talking about lots of things. We need a day, really, I think, Kevin, to talk about all of your escapades. But we're talking about your musical career now and your songwriting career. And like a lot of musicians today, they're all publishing their own stuff, which gives you a bit of autonomy, doesn't it? And direction over where you want your music to be heard and seen. So if listeners are interested in your music, where can we find you?
Well, if you go to distrokid.com, you'll find I've got Hyperfollow there. If you go into Spotify, Apple Music, Amazon, Deezer, Google Play, all of the major platforms, I did this through DistroKid. So if this is a company which are really good. They publish on your behalf to all the different platforms. Although if you want the physical thing, I've actually got printed copies of the CD. So that's the thing. If you're like me, you like a bit of the old-fashioned way, You can get, if you get in touch through my socials, which are on Facebook at the Kevin Devine, you'll get my music page there. On Twitter and on Instagram, it's at Devine DevineENC, which is short for Divine Encounters. So that was the handle that I grabbed for that. And if you get in touch, you know, DM me, just go onto one of my posts or whatever. I can send you the links there. The links should be on the pages anyway. And if anyone wants a CD, get in touch with me and we'll do a little, you know, I do have to charge something, but, you know.
Of course you do, because you have to try and, I mean, the streaming today is dire, isn't it? I mean, there's a lot of creative people out there creating extremely good content, but they're not getting the recognition they deserve, are they? No. Because it is a crowded market, and yes, there is some music, but it all comes down to taste. It doesn't mean something's good or bad. It's all down to taste, you know, and you've joined a collective. And that's something that I'm quite passionate about, is because I think when you get two collaborators together, one may be more advanced than the other, but you put them both together and they both get elevated, don't they?
Absolutely. And that's what I'm enjoying about the co-writing just now. I've actually started. And sometimes it's a lot easier. I did a course 3 weeks ago with the Song Centre. And they brought together about 8-10 people who were all songwriters or want to learn more. We all had different levels of ability, but we were thrown together. And it's funny what happens, because the people who aren't quite as experienced still can come out with some wonderful ideas and wonderful stuff. And that's the whole beauty of the collaborative process, because like you say, it spirals upwards. We help each other elevate. Yeah. And whereas when you're sitting yourself, you're going, God, I need an idea. I'm stuck a bit with that. What can I do? And sometimes you're just banging your head off the brick wall. Although what I do in a place like this, I'll go and do something mechanical. I'll go out and cut the grass or something. And that actually frees up the side of the brain that's the creative side, my right side. The left side's all the mechanical stuff. And when that doesn't interfere, the ideas come through.
Yeah, and it's amazing where you get your ideas from, isn't it? You know, you could meet somebody, or you could be in a queue, or you're in the car, and you're listening to somebody else's music, and suddenly it will spark off an emotion or a memory, and you'll think, oh, I'm going to write a song. Or sometimes you get, and I do it quite a lot, is I have an idea, and I sing a song in my head, and I go, oh, that worked quite well. I'll go and get a piece of paper. I've got the piece of paper, I've forgotten it.
Yeah. You need the phone, you go to the voice memo section or whatever you can do. I don't know if you can see, there's 201 things there. They're all little song ideas. and things, because I keep that, like you're standing waiting in a bus or something, and you go, oh, and I've stood there and people think I'm mad because I start going, ba 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 ba, I'm humming a melody or something, or I'll even sing in some lyrics and then I'll just go, right, that's as much as I've got just now. And they're standing, so, and they back away from you. They'll move away a bit. I don't want to stand next to him. But funnily enough, the next song I'm going to ask you to play is off the album. And talking about where the idea came from, it's track number 2 called Brand New Friend. And I got the idea for that when I was flying over Thailand from Bangkok down to the south of Thailand. And I looked down and it was a beautiful day, but there were little, tiny little clouds, just tiny little clouds. And we were above them. And I noticed that the cloud, you could see the shadow on the sea.
Yes,
And I went, oh, look at that. Every cloud casts a shadow from the sun. And I went, oh, my God. Oh,
I like that. Yeah.
And again, the goosebumps have just gone up. And that, I just kept saying, don't forget this. Every cloud casts a shadow from the sun. And then when I came home, I composed the song around it. And that's the opening line of Brand New Friend. And that was the first little thing that you get, the first little stitch that then becomes the garment. So it was that was the story of getting the inspiration for that song.
Oh, well, let's have a listen to that then. This is Brand New Friend by Kevin Devine.
By the hand and carry on. can call it home. A bus, a train will set me for the day. Or a friendly stranger passing by who's going on my way. Cause I'm a rolling stone. I just can't settle down. And I feel the
fabulous, Kevin, where a song comes from out of nowhere, a plane journey. You're looking at the clouds like we all do. We all look out the window, don't we? And inspiration. And that's what creativity is all about, isn't it? It's that spontaneous moment.
Well, funnily enough, talking about being up in the air and it's not musical creativity here. Yesterday, I was lucky enough to fly in a Spitfire over my house, down by the English Channel. It was an amazing experience. And that was at Biggin Hill. And it was a once in a lifetime present for my wife. And I'm ever so grateful because I've been fascinated by Spitfires all my life.
There isn't many flying, is there? There isn't many flying.
There's not. But where I was at Biggin Hill, they're actually rebuilding them because as people find remains of old aircraft, they're getting the money, they're getting the funding to put them together. And I, for the life, I cannot remember the fella who owns it now. I was told his name yesterday and I apologise. If he listens, I've forgotten your name, but he got the inspiration. He was an ex-commercial pilot, and he was asked one day about 20 years ago, I think about 2000, 23 years ago, if he wouldn't mind flying a Spitfire from Belgium or Holland to Biggin Hill. And he went, of course, I'd love to do that. And as he was flying over the channel and over the White Cliffs of Dover, he had a eureka moment to actually say, do you know what? I'm going to start a company that people can rebuild these things and they can also fly in them. And they converted one, he managed to get a plane, they converted it to a two-seater. So yesterday I was up above the clouds, down to the English Channel, turn left along towards Dungeness and back, and it was just amazing. And that was the eureka moment. And that's what I'm saying. You don't know where you're going to be. You could be sitting in the loo, you could be out cutting the grass, washing the car, whatever. Especially when you're doing mundane tasks like that, that's when inspiration strikes.
Yeah. And isn't it marvellous? It all comes back to one thing, which is driven by helping other people to enjoy an experience that you enjoy.
Absolutely.
You enjoy writing your music. You enjoy playing your music. You enjoy creating sound and other people enjoy it. That's the bonus when they enjoy what you do. But you do it because you enjoy it. And it enhances somebody else's life by creating another memory or it moving them in some sort of way. And that's the joy, which is free, isn't it? It's a free thing. You either take it on board or you don't.
Creativity is free. And why, you know, people who are creative sort of get it. But people who aren't creative can still be creative.
Yes.
They just need to hone it and listen for these little moments that inspire them. And if they do it a little bit more, they can actually start polishing that talent. Because everyone's got a bit of talent somewhere hidden. They just tend to not, they get distracted by the life stuff, you know, life things get in the way. So, and it's about allowing yourself a bit of time to do that.
We're going to listen to another song of yours, which is called Searching for the Answers. So I'm going to ask you quite a tough question. Is there something in this world at the moment that you don't know the answer to, but you would love to know the answer to?
Do you know, there are so many things I don't know.
I did think there might be.
Because that's the only thing I can say for definite. The older I get, the less I know, because I realise there's more out there to find out about. And anyone who turns around and tells you they know everything, just walk away from them at that point. They're deluded. It's like, I'm a Tai Chi teacher as well, and I've been doing it for 22, 23 years now. And I still learn every day when I'm doing the postures and I'm doing the forms and things. There'll be something you're informed about every, oh, it feels like that. You should do this. You move your body that way. So, and my teacher, I'm a student, even though I'm a teacher, he's been doing it for nearly 14 years, and he's going, you'll never guess what I had an insight on, Kev. Let's work this out. And so you're still unpacking things. It's like the Russian doll.
That's strange. Isn't that strange? While you're doing that, I've just seen you doing your robotic dance that was inspired by Visage all those years ago.
It has crossed my mind.
You're doing Tai Chi, which is kind of robotic, isn't it?
Tai Chi is far more smooth and
fluid. Yeah.
If you do, you know, the robotic movements were very linear and very straight, whereas everything in Tai Chi is very circular. So it's sort of the other side of the coin, which is very appropriate because the Tai Chi symbol has yin and yang in it.
Yeah.
So it's both sides of the coin. So, but every day is a school day, Suzanne. Every day is a school day.
What next for you, Kevin? Because we're going to run out of time, but we're going to end on your new single, Searching for the Answers. So what's next for you? What's coming up?
What's coming up is the new EP. So I've got the songs together now. I've done the lyrics. I've done the arrangements. So I need to tighten things up a little bit on the production side. And then I'll go into a studio. I'll get people who are far brighter than me with that side of it to do it for me. I'd love to think that maybe sometime down the line I could co-write with Rusty Egan. That would be an amazing experience.
Rusty, if you're listening, there's an invite. He does hang about London quite a lot, and I can't remember Annabelle's. He's in Annabelle's.
Right, because he always loved his clubs.
If you go into London, you can tap him on the shoulder and say, Suzanne says you've got to talk to me. And he'll go, she said what?
She said what? You know, I don't know you, mate, but you know, so. But no, that, yeah. Suzanne said, right, okay. I literally bumped into him once as I was coming out of a pub in London. And I went to him, I said, that's Rusty Egan. But he'd gone back in, and he was very in a very animated conversation with a friend. And I thought, I don't want to interrupt him. You know, because he's really, you know, flowing in the conversation. So, but I knew who he was. I went, that's Rusty Egan, you know.
Yeah.
So, and as I say, I loved all that time, the Blitz Kids, Steve Strange, you know, Maggio was around, hanging around Boy George, just all of these great creatives.
Yeah.
I met Michelle Clapton recently for the very first time. She went on to become this Emmy award-winning costume designer for things like Game of Thrones and Downton, all of these big period pieces of fantasy thing. She's an amazing designer. So and they all live down in the South Coast now. A lot of the big Blitz kids are down here now.
So that was
my era, Suzanne. You know,
I'm me too. You know, I mean, I'll tell you a funny, very funny story now. I met Midge in a hangar. He was rehearsing for a show, and Rusty doesn't drive, so we hooked up, and I said, look, I'll drive you. You know, he said, well, I'm going to this place, and I'm going to do some rehearsals. He never told me what he was going for or who he was meeting. So I'm in the car with him, and we're sitting at traffic lights, and he took over my stereo system in the car, and he put on Back to Burundi. Now, I love the drums. And so we're in the car at traffic lights on red. There's a car next to me here, and we're both going, Back to Burundi. These people next door kind of looked at us and thought, what's going on there? Anyway, so I get to this place, this airfield, where I was just dropping him off. And typical style with Rusty, come on in, have a cup of tea. And as I walked in, this kind of, I'm quite sure, I'm only 5'4", So this guy walks up towards us, and I didn't recognize him at first. And he goes to Rusty, "Are you here all day?" And he said to me, "Are you taking him back again?" I went, "Yeah, I've got a hotel for him. I'll take him back." And I didn't realize it was Midjour. And so he said, "Did you bring him here?" And I went, "Yeah." And he said, "Oh, good luck with that." He said, "Did he talk you to death?" And I went, "Yeah." And then he went, "Rusty, your guest list is bigger than mine." He said, "And that can't happen." So he said, "We need to have a little bit of a chat." And there I was in this room, in this hangar, in the middle of nowhere with Midjour and Rusty. And I'm standing there going, I would have killed for that moment when I was in my teens. Absolutely killed. Never in my wildest dreams. And it was only because I'd met Rusty by chance. Another long story. And that is what I think is wonderful about meeting the people that I meet through the radio, is that we all have these connections, you know, that we don't have, and then we make them, and suddenly you think, wow, you know?
Yeah.
And people recommend and collaborate together, and that, I think, there can't be anything more colourful in life than being creative.
No. It's what life is all about.
Yeah.
And it's why, it's what colours life. You think through COVID, what kept people going?
Yeah.
Music, drama, films. Yep. All of the creative industries, because that was all people had left at times to keep them from going mad.
Yeah.
And that's why the music and the film, they should all be valued.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Valued. Without a shadow of a doubt.
And I might sound as if I'm lecturing here, but youngsters need to realise they need to start buying music rather than just Spotify or whatever. Music isn't free.
No.
It's not free. Because we've all had to put a lot of time in. And you wouldn't go into a carpenter's workshop and say, "Right, I'm just going to take that chair, mate.
Yeah.
I'll give you half a pence, or, you know, 0.0 every time I maybe think about sitting on it." That's not how it works. So at the risk of lecturing, buy the music.
Yeah, just buy and support your artists. You've enjoyed listening to Kevin today, please go and look him up on Spotify, on Facebook, on Twitter, wherever you can find him, because it's wonderful to have talked to you today, Kevin. And thank you so much for your time. Honestly, I could talk to you all day. I know I could. And I know you could talk to me all day as well.
I told you I would play that. So good luck with, if you're going to edit that, good luck, you know. So. It's been a pleasure, Suzanne. Thank you for having me on the show.
No, thank you. Thank you for agreeing to do it too, Kevin. And honestly, I wish you lots of luck with your music. And I, for one, have downloaded it all. Kevin, before you go, we are going to play Searching for the Answers. So just very quickly, tell our listeners what inspired that song.
It was what was initially a little synth hook that I came up with on the thing. And then I was actually trying to get sort of an idea. And I thought, I'm searching for the answer here. That's a good line. So it sort of came from there. So I started, you know, writing I wrote the verses first, and I couldn't get a melody for the chorus until one night. I was working in my wife and I have a big wholesale bakery, and I was actually slicing bread, and I was doing something mechanical, and I started just humming the tune along because the thing was so noisy I could sing it, and then I suddenly came up with the chorus, and I went, "Oh my God!" Grabbed the phone. So the original recording I've got has got all the machinery in the background as I'm working, I'm singing this in, and I've managed to put it all together. So it was about that. It was just that one line again. Oh, what am I going to do with this song? I'm searching for the answer. Oh, there you go. And that's what brought it about.
And that's what did it. So a last question for you, a daredevil, Kevin. What is one of the things, you sort of bucket list ambition, you haven't done yet that you'd like to do?
Do you know, I don't know now, because the Spitfire, flying in the Spitfire was one of the bucket lists.
Yeah.
I've met people who want to jump out of planes. I'm not sure about that one, actually, I have to say. Although, I've, people say it's wonderful. My pal who was there with me yesterday, he said it's amazing. So maybe it would be that.
Right.
I think that would be the next thing, because I think that would be a real barrier I'd need to push through. So it would be good for my growth.
Well, I'll come and interview you when you get on the ground. I'm not going up, but I'll come and see you when you're on the ground.
But Suzanne, it's been a joy. Thank you.
No, thank you. It's been a pleasure and a joy for me too. Go and enjoy your Sunday with your lovely wife, and apologise for us interrupting her Sunday.
That's all. This is all cool. Though I'm looking for the answers to some questions, but I don't even know searching.